how happy and how free I was there. And I remember it so clear, because soon it ended, abruptly and sudden. On the evening of October 4th, just 3 weeks after my 21st birthday, my life just turned upside down and the new chapter began. On that evening, I was abducted from the streets of my hometown just on my way home. It happened in a country that does not even exist anymore, the Soviet Union. Evil empire, I believe Ronald Reagan called it. I grew up in Astrakhan, it's the name of the city, and it's one of the oldest and diverse city in the southern part of Russia. It's inhabited by hundreds of different ethnic groups, from Persian to Chinese. My childhood was wonderful. It was carefree and fun. I graduated from high school and went to university, and my student life was just like other thousands of other students here in the United States and in Russia. So it was like my childhood was free and happy, but it was already filled with great dreams, bright future. You know, you probably remember the feelings from your youth. So my student time began in 1991, actually, when Russia was wrecked by earth-shattering changes. After the disintegration of Russia, the new history began, and it was known as World 90s. So for 70 years, just imagine, for 70 years, our central government was controlling and watching every aspect of people's life. And then suddenly, in 1991, the Soviet Union collapsed and absolute freedom came. It seemed like all human sins were locked behind the walls of the huge castle. So all of a sudden, masses of drug addicts, thieves, murderers, and maniacs just came and set loose to run free. In 1991, the abduction for ransom became an established business practice. Criminals from all over the country engaged in it, and especially people from Chechnya. This is the small Muslim area in not far away from my hometown. And every citizen, including myself, we heard so many terrible cases about kidnappings and abductions, and was playing constantly on the TV and the news. But for me, it seemed so distant. It seemed like something that could never happen in my own life. So it was 1994. In the evening of October 4th, I was at the party with my friends in the restaurant just across the road from my home. We were having fun. We were celebrating our youth and beauty, our great hopes, bright future. And I went into an argument with my boyfriend over something silly, and I decided to leave the party. And next thing I knew, I was surrounded by strangers speaking in foreign language. They dragged me and drove me to some other place where they kept me prisoner in a tiny room with blacked out windows. So for the first time of my captivity, I didn't know where I was, why I was there, and I didn't know what was anyone was saying. Just later on, they told me I was abducted and moved to Chechnya. And they were trying to ransom me back to my mom. So needless to say, I was feeling so lonely in that world, new and weird and strange world to me. Thrown out of the water like a helpless fish and thrown ashore to die. I no longer needed to see all the news about abductions on the TV. Now I was a part of it. Oh, thank you so much. I know I will need it. First few weeks I was certain that special forces, some kind of special police, SWAT team, would storm the building one dark night and save me. And I would have preferred to never wake up until the day of my salvation. But then the war broke out. I can tell you it was a terrible war where more than 100,000 people killed. For me, the events went from bad to worse. Then the power went out. There was no mail service, there was no telegraph service, no telephone service. There could be no negotiation for my release. Chechnya declared their independence, but Russia did not allow it. So Russian army invaded the country and it turned into the killing, awful killing zone. And I was, as you said, from the heart, I was like one lost soul at mercy of criminals who declared themselves patriotic fighters. I can tell you that I experienced and I saw things that no one should have to go through. I witnessed atrocities. They threatened me to cut in pieces and send to my mom. I just would like to tell you a little story from my book. When I was being held, one morning the captors decided to take me out of the room and outside. I had no idea where we were going. They put a bandage on my eyes and we just drove somewhere. When they parked and let me to remove the bandage, I immediately saw the evidence of recent fightings, bullet-scarred buildings, charred by fire, new snow, white color was mixed with brown and red with, you know, mud and blood, with smears of bright red. And there were tanks, Russian tanks and trucks just thrown at you like broken toys. I just figured that we were in the downtown of the center of the city. And I was in the car, just staring through the window. They parked near a large tree with massive branches spread on the side. The tree was bare. There were no leaves at all. And I noticed something was lodged on the branches, on every crook, carefully lodged. And it wasn't one something, it was several of them. I just stared and stared at those things, just trying to figure out what they were. Then one captor, just behind me, he said, "That's what will be left of all Russians who can come to our country." So, the things lodged on the tree were human heads. Cut off heads of Russian soldiers, plastered with mud and blood. I thought that would vomit or pass out. But the captors were talking in their unknowable language behind me. Their voices were cheerful and excited. They were happy. They were jubilant. This atrocity, this disgrace, for them it was victory to be celebrated, while being in captivity. I lacked the most basic things in my life. But you know, I was ready to accept it. I could live without it. It was impossible to accept the lack of personal freedom. And witnessing these atrocities were beyond my strength. But I fought desperately to stay sane, stay alive, and not lose one thing that kept me going, my hope. Hope sustained me, and faith sustained me. best you can hope for in the moments of total and all-embracing despair. The more desperate the situation, the more, the stronger faith becomes, the stronger we become. So, was I a victim? Definitely I was a victim. I was a victim of people who engaged in organized crime, human trafficking, and kidnapping. I was also a victim of a war that I knew nothing about and I didn't want any part of it. I was a triple victim and I was a quadruple victim, if you can count everything that happened to me then. But you know, I think we're much bigger and much stronger than the things that happen to us. Sometimes, you know, in our lives at some point, we are all victims. People can steal from us. We can get sick, perhaps we can get cancer. We are losing our loved ones. Incredible tragedies are happening in our lives. But we are much bigger and much stronger than all of that. At some point in my life, I don't know when, I don't remember then in the captivity or later, I decided for myself, I would like to become a survivor. I didn't want to remain a victim. And I like being a survivor. Survivors take action. Survivors learn from the past and make use of it, and ultimately transcend them. So I just believe, and I would like to believe, that everyone can do that choice, no matter how hardship we face in life.